thought it would be fitting on this day to first talk about this idea of spiritual sovereignty. And I'm curious how many of you have heard of that phrase before, spiritual sovereignty. Okay. According to Google, spiritual sovereignty is a clear statement of boundaries with the confidence that you are backed up by universal law. This is a state of being where you lay claim to your own space, to your physical body, to your mind and heart, declaring them as your own, and that you accept ownership of yourself fully, including both the good and what we might call the shadow sides of you. There is a further definition that I found too that I thought really nailed this definition. And it said, when you are spiritually sovereign, you remember that you are God and not the collection of false personas fabricated as your ego. You know that God is your innermost self, and because of this, you do not allow yourself to be persuaded otherwise. You acknowledge that you are here to give voice and expression to this divine emanation that you are within the mind of God. Isn't that beautiful? So I thought that that was fitting because it's sort of an Independence Day for your soul, right? And it's a juxtaposition of two ideas, really, that might seem mutually exclusive. How can we be independent, you know, a sovereign being, and also how can we be one with God at the same time? Well, the reason why you can come into your sovereignty and in your fullness and into your power, after all, another word for sovereign is acting with full power, is because you are backed up by God and you are born out of God. You are all that God is. So I love this idea of spiritual sovereignty. And I thought I would add on, I looked up the word sovereign this morning and it says possessing ultimate power, acting independently without outside interference. Now, our country sought to do that 245 years ago today. And in a way, we must do that as we seek our spiritual sovereignty. And outside interference means errant thoughts. Outside interference means all that is not us. It means doubt. It means feelings of lack and limitation. It means emulating others and comparing ourselves to others and placing ourselves in a less than instead of a I am as great as any, okay? So I'd like to share the thoughts of two spiritual leaders who spoke to this sovereignty in two different ways to me recently. One of them is Matt Kahn, who did a workshop for us and about 618 other people the other night. And for those who missed Matt Kahn's workshop, it was fascinating. It was different. It was interesting. It was very different. Much of his message didn't have a full impact for me until later because I was a bit shocked by his delivery in what he called a transmission. He looked directly into the camera the entire time, barely blinking. His gaze was so intense. And in between his statements, he would pause. And it reminded me of a friend talking about a movie he saw. I think he saw Claudia Cristina Barcelona, if that's the right name of the movie. And he said that Javier Bardem in that movie was so fully present that it was intimidating to people. It made others uncomfortable in a way. So I did feel a little uncomfortable not knowing what to do with this person staring at me, even though it was on Zoom. I felt he could see me. Part of me wanted to hide. And I realized that was my issue. So if I could get past that issue, that would be a productive thing for me. And he called his session a transmission, which is probably channeling. And I began to ask myself, oh, is he really channeling or is he not? And then I remembered, well, what did I say about Esther Hicks? Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if it was channeled. It doesn't matter because isn't it all channeled? It's all channeled. So I just needed to shut my brain up and listen with receptivity. And once I got more into that comfort zone, I began to appreciate the message, and I listened to it over the next few days and took a lot of notes, and I want to share some of those takeaways. If I could sum up his message in my words, it would be, love yourself radically. All the events that brought you here today, all the arc of your whole life, love all of that inclusively, because you are the one. And all of those things brought you here to do the great things that you're being called to do. Only you can do those great things. No one else is going to fulfill this mission that you must fulfill. And Matt Kahn specifically said, the more loving you allow yourself to be in a radical way towards yourself and towards others, the bigger the doorway of light that your human body becomes, so that the amount of light can enter the world and ignite the spark in other human beings. This in turn illuminates the entire planet. So it begins with you. And he spoke of these two juxtaposed ideas of exclusivity and inclusivity. And we're not talking about racial or gender exclusivity, inclusivity. We're talking about a greater all-encompassing exclusivity and inclusivity. And I'll tell you what I mean. Exclusivity means looking at the moments of, according to Matt Kahn, looking at the moments of embarrassment and innocence in your life and saying, that wasn't me. I'm only the positive milestones. I'm only the resume stuff, right? But that isn't the complete picture, is it? Think of a failure in your life that propelled you into a better place. In fact, think of all the failures in your life that may have propelled you into a better place. And in the words of Marilyn Pels, that perhaps gave you a depth and texture. You know, I was thinking, wouldn't it be boring if all of our lives were successes and smooth? We would be very boring. So these failures give us this texture, give us, as you might have heard me say before, all the pain and loss that we've ever carried carves more deeply the bowl that contains our deepest happiness, our deepest joy. And if we don't have these lows, we have a very shallow bowl, right? Because we don't know the depths of our being. So this is where inclusivity comes in. Matt Kahn described it as, from the date of your birth to the date of your body's death, while there are things that you may regret or that you wish you could have done differently, you needed to be exactly who you were in order to be as you are, and you need to be exactly as you are to become who you will be. That is powerful. And on a path of inclusivity, you don't need to judge the lows, says Matt Kahn. This is just building momentum for the discovery. You're making space for a greater high. So when there's inclusivity, you're not wrong. You're never wrong. You're just right for the process that you are in. And so are others. So everything is awake is a part of your awakening process. And that's a really powerful idea to me. Matt Kahn also talked about this different viewpoint, this different window to look through when you see the word problem in your life. And he said, the only way to solve a problem is to wake up out of seeing it as a problem and see it as a process. So that's inclusivity too. And he talked about the butterfly struggling to break out of the chrysalis, needing the courage and the strength with which it must summon on its own to become the butterfly. Because he said, if someone else tries to interfere in that process, the butterfly won't survive. You can't help a butterfly. You can't help a butterfly. Oh, I'm going to help you open that cocoon, right? That person needs to find their own way, and you can be standing by for support, right? So within this view of seeing your life, seeing problems as processes, and seeing yourself as this potential butterfly, every single detail, according to Matt Kahn, every single detail of your life is an essential, necessary component to building up the inner momentum to cause your consciousness to explode in remembrance of who you really are. And that's beautiful. This so reminded me, whenever I hear, remember who you really are, it reminds me of someone that was very special to me. Her name was Anita Devine, and she passed away some years ago. And it just so happens that today, July 4th, would have been her birthday. And she told me many times, we came here to forget so we can walk the journey back home of remembering again who we really are. We came here to forget so we could walk the journey back home of remembering who we really are. And that's what we're doing. And another thing that she said always, she always ended our time with having us say together, I am God, I am. I am God, I am. And the Western mind gets a little freaked out about saying that, because although that's true, our history tells us that's a sin. That's pride. In fact, you know, I went to UCLA and I discovered at that time great European architecture. You know, Royce Hall on the campus of UCLA is these two huge towers. And on one of the towers, they're bell towers. And on one, there are two windows. And on the other, there are three windows. And I wondered, why is that? Why don't they both have two windows or both have three windows? It's because European architecture is built with the idea embedded that we are imperfect before God. How dare we try to be perfect into the skies? So that humbleness is built in, if you will. But we need to get out of that, because this I am God, I am, is a very special place. Ernest Holmes, in the book, This Thing Called You, said the vision, and by the way, Ernest Holmes is the founder of CSL, known as Religious Science before this, and he's a contemporary of Ernest Holmes a contemporary of Myrtle and Charles Fillmore. But he said, the vision you must catch and hold is the consciousness of a union so complete and so perfect that you find no difference between your own being and God. The two are one. I'll say that again. The vision you must catch and hold is the conscious union so complete and perfect that you find no difference between your own being and God. The two are one. And isn't it true that 2,000 years ago, they wanted to kill Jesus because he prayed from such a place? It was a radical idea then, and it remains our work to this day to fully express this idea, fully express this radical awareness of our sovereignty within God. So we must find this this space where we feel fully worthy because we're backed up by God, regardless of outside influence. That also reminds me of a quote that I put on Facebook this week from Osho, who said, "Your value does not decrease based upon someone's inability to see your worth. Your value does not decrease based upon someone else's inability to see your worth." A few weeks ago, I talked to you about, I was doing some house cleaning, this dusting, this Swedish death cleaning, if you will. And it's an emotional process. And as I continue that, I came across a picture that I drew a couple of days ago on a notebook. And I didn't throw it away. I wanted to save it. And then the next day I said, oh, you got to throw that away. But then I thought, wait a minute, why throw this picture away? This picture is valuable. Isn't it just as valuable as a Rembrandt? Isn't it just as valuable as a Monet? And if not, why not? Why is my art less valuable than Picasso? I mean, Picasso could have drawn a squiggle on a piece of paper and it would sell today for millions. But my squiggle is worth nothing? Think about that. Think about the value we assign to other people just because of who they were, right? And someone could reproduce their work perfectly and get pennies for it because it's a reproduction. It didn't come from him, right? So this is this comparative attitude. There's an author named Coote Blackson, who you may have heard of. He wrote a book called You Are the One. And he said that you are the artist of your life. And you need to think of your life as being a canvas, your life as being your art. So you must create a life that is your masterpiece, whether it's intentional or unintentional, right? This author, Coote Blackson, I want to talk about him a little bit more because a lot of his messaging was right in line with what Matt Kahn was talking about. In fact, the name of the book that he wrote was You Are the One, which Matt Kahn repeated a lot during his workshop. And in the beginning of his book, he talks about going to India. He talks about seeing beggars there. And he saw one beggar in particular who was playing a drum. And he was doing a really good job at playing this drum and he was singing along with it. And as he got closer, he realized the beggar sitting there had no hands. He was playing the drum with he had stubs for arms, but he was playing that drum and singing, and he had stubs for legs. He couldn't walk. Adding to that, the beggar was blind, but he was still singing. So the author, Coote Blackson, went up to him and said, "How can you be so joyful? How can you sing like this? How can you do this every day? Come out here and just do this." And the beggar said, "What else is there to do but love? What else is there to do but love?" And so they talked and they spent time together. And before they parted, the beggar said to Coote Blackson, "You just need to share your gifts with the world. Who you are is a gift. And by not sharing who you really are with the world, you are robbing the world of something that it needs." Isn't that interesting? By not sharing your gift with the world, you're robbing them of something that they need. And so that inspired him to write this book. In this book called You Are the One, Coote Blackson talked about personas, as I talked about at the top of my talk. He talked about personas that we use to fit into certain roles based upon comparing ourselves with others and based upon becoming comfortable in life. And he asks, which one of these are you? Maybe you're none of them. Maybe you're several of them. But he said these personas are the victim, the saint, the drama queen, the martyr, the know-it-all, and the rebel. Okay, the victim, the saint, the drama queen, the martyr, the know-it-all, and the rebel. And he said it's easy to fall into one of these roles based upon what other people want and what other people expect, or sometimes just to make peace with yourself or to feel safe, right? But the questions to ask yourself that are the catalytic, is that a word? The catalyst questions are, what have you been suppressing that fits outside of this realm? What other yous are there? And what part of you is screaming to be expressed? What persona is screaming to be expressed? So that's a good question to meditate on. I mean, he talks about all the great people in the world that he sees as people who don't emulate anyone else, who didn't emulate anyone else. And he mentioned this mixture of people that included Gandhi, Mother Teresa, Picasso, Mozart. And as I say these names, think about, they all defied what was going on currently, right? Galileo, Isaac Newton, Bruce Lee. He created a form of martial arts that was so crazy, was so different. It was like jazz. It was combining everything from everywhere. Elvis Presley, John Lennon, Bob Marley, Steve Jobs. Maybe you can name a few people. They don't have to be famous, but who are those that chose not to emulate other people? So I'll wrap up the message of Coot Blackson with these further pieces of advice that he has towards attaining this spiritual sovereignty. He says, forget who you think you are and find out who you really are. The appearance of fear doesn't mean you should stop. Right at the edge of your comfort zone is where the real growth begins. And as you transform yourself, you don't just do it for yourself, but for every human being on the planet. They benefit too. So, in conclusion, how do I wrap all this up? This idea of sovereignty on Independence Day, spiritual sovereignty. I think some key things to remember are that life is a process and not a problem. Your problems, big or small, are processes, part of the process that you need to honor. And that we need to honor this whole arc of who we are, including the light and the shadow side, right? The other message is to love yourself radically. Love yourself radically more than you love anyone. Recognizing that your failures as well as your successes have brought you here. You needed to be exactly as you were in order to be as you are. And you need to be as you are to become who you will be. This is spiritual sovereignty. There's no time to waste in being someone else. And so it is.
You can spend your whole life building something from nothing. One storm can come and blow it all away. build it anyway. You can chase a dream that seems so out of reach, and you know it might not ever come your way. Dream it anyway. Cause God is great, and sometimes life ain't good, and when I pray, doesn't always turn out like I think it should, but I do it anyway. I do it anyway. This world's gone crazy, and it's hard to believe that tomorrow will be better than today. Believe it anyway. You can love someone with all your heart for all the right reasons, and in a moment they can choose to walk away. Love them anyway. This God is great, and sometimes life ain't good, and when I pray, doesn't always turn out like I think it should, but I do it anyway. Do it anyway. You can pour your soul out singing a song you believe in, that tomorrow they'll forget you ever sang. Sing it anyway. Sing it anyway.
So now let's take a moment to just relax into a meditative space, drawing our attention to our body, seated perfectly upon the chair or the couch that we're sitting on. With a straight spine, feeling a sense of groundedness as you feel your feet connected to the floor. Noticing your consciousness just open and relax as you slow your breath. Let this meditation be a blessing for you. Mm-hmm. Bless your feet for all the places that they have taken you, all the places they have traveled. Bless your arms for all they have embraced. Bless your eyes for everything that they have seen. Bless your ears for all that they have heard. Bless your voice for everything that you have said. Bless your mind for its willingness to change. Bless your heart for loving yourself more each day. Bless your body temple for carrying the miracle that you are. You are a blessing. Just notice yourself breathing deeply into this place of blessing. Blessing for all that you have been throughout the entire arc of your life. Blessing for all that you are now. Blessing all that you are becoming each day and each moment as this dynamic, divine life. Relax into the awareness of you as a gift, not only a gift to the world, but a gift to yourself. As you grow in this relationship between you and you, between the you that is fully human and the you that is fully divine. And with this awareness and this gratitude of this blessed state that you are, let's just be in the silence for a few moments. As we draw our attention back to our breath and back into this space, I give a blessing to this community. This moment would not be the same if it weren't for your presence in this room. I give a blessing to all the awareness, to all the the music and the message, and to God in all of our lives. And so it is.